We're going through this book on Nehemiah on how to do leadership, kind of thinking outside the box. And some amazing study here out of the book of Nehemiah. I've just really, really enjoyed this myself. And we're looking at principles from God's Word. And you know, it's amazing. You read all these leadership books and they get all their information. I mean, all the information you've ever read really is right here in the book of Nehemiah. But the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 14 and 40, everything should be done in a fitting and orderly way. I just feel like the more we get like God, the more fitting and more orderly we really are. How many of you had some years of your life you were very disorderly? That's what I knew. And so the longer you're around God, the more orderly you become. But we've looked at the principles of leadership. We said that first, a leader prays. You start off with prayer. Second, he plans. The third thing, he presents the plan to the people he's working with. And he motivates the people. But all of that other stuff we talked about would be no good without organization. Because, you know, I grew up in a church where they'd go, well, you need to do this, and you need to do that, and you need to do that. And if you don't do this, you're going to hell. But they never told us how to do it. And so it led to a lot of frustration. And so, today I want to give you a few principles of successful organizations. Number one principle is simplification. Keep it simple. We actually used to have a term when I was young in business that they'd say it's the KISS principle. You know what the KISS principle is? Keep it simple, stupid. Now, we normally don't say stupid in church, but that applies to some people maybe, but I don't know. But anyways, that was the principle. Keep it simple, stupid. For such an enormous project, Nehemiah, there was a need with such an enormous project to keep the plan simple. A simple plan of organization. He didn't assign any jobs by lottery. You know, like, we're going to draw out a hat, and whatever job you get to have that job. No, he didn't do lottery. He didn't cast lots. He didn't create a whole new organization and start a whole new organizational chart. When I first started pastoring, you know, I was appointed to churches, and I'd go in there and, you know, I'd look and go, oh my God, yeah, this is the best people the pastor could find to do these jobs. And I would be thinking, well, against better judgment, you know, I'd say, well, I'm going to search around. I'm going to get to know some people. Well, some people were really, really nice to me. And, you know, they would take you out to eat and they would talk to you. I would really like to do that job in the church. So, you know, it came appointment day and I'd appoint them all to these jobs. And then I realized why the pastor was using them. Other people. Because they were faithful and they were dependable. And he was using the cream of the crop. I just didn't know where the cream was. And actually, Nehemiah, he tried to use already developed organizations there. It said the priest in verse 1, the men of Jericho in verse 2, the sons of Hezaniah in verse 3, the men of Tikio in verse 5. These are all natural groups that are already associated together. So he used what he had. Kind of used what got you there. The point is, don't create organizations if you don't need to. If there's already organizations, try to work within the groups that you already have. What is the most natural groupings of organization? Well, in Nehemiah's situation, it was the family. In Nehemiah 14 and 13, he posted them by families for support. The first law of leadership, the strongest organizations are the simplest. It's just like when you buy toys for your kids or your grandkids. The simplest toys are the most non-breakable toys. If you buy your kid a little wood block, there's not much they can do to hurt that block. But if you buy your kid and something has 19 moving pieces, they're going to find a way to break that. So actually, the simpler it is, the stronger it is. And that's the same way with organizations. If you can just have a simple operating organization, it'll be much stronger than a complicated one. The second principle is participation. Work with those who want to work. A lot of leaders never learn this. They spend all their time trying to corral the lazy and the apathetic instead of working with those who want to work. I call it corralling goats or herding cats. It's hard to do. or corralling goats. Almost everybody got involved, almost everybody. All available help was put to work if they were available. The religious leaders led the way. Men and women, the people in the city and the people in the country, the white collar and the blue collar, there were perfume makers, goldsmiths, and everybody got involved. Government leaders, business leaders, everybody was moving bricks and everybody was making mortar. Except one little group, we'll read about them. Verse 5, the next section was repaired by men of Tekoa, but their nobles would not put their shoulders to work under their supervisors. These guys think they're too hot, too good. They thought the work was beneath them, moving bricks, that is. It doesn't say what excuse they gave for not working, but I found in every church you have those kind of people. In every community, in every business, you got some that's going to work and some think they're too good for work. I call them the workers and the shirkers. You know, you always got those that's willing to work and those that will shirk the job. Nehemiah's response to these shirkers was to ignore them. He did not focus on those who were not willing to work. He focused on those who were willing to work. He didn't lose sleep. He didn't become bitter. He didn't waste time trying to corral them. He worked with those that were willing to work. We first started this church, you know, we're sitting up here now. When we started this building, we was trying to deal with the other building and this building. We were building it, you know, we'd call a work day and some would show and I'd drag around for a half hour being upset with all the ones that didn't show. It's like in my early days preaching, I'd get up and I'd preach. And I'd have people here, but I'd be preaching mad about all the ones that didn't show up. And I'm sure they was thinking, hey, don't preach to me like I'm not here, I'm here. You're preaching to the guys that's already out there playing golf. So I learned to preach to who came. Forget about those that didn't come. Ignore that. And that's what he did. He worked with what he had. He worked with what he had. Leaders love everybody, but they move with the movers. In every organization, family, church, whatever you're trying to get together, you know, you can say, I want to go, and some will say, no, I don't want to be involved. Focus on the ones that want to get involved. Third principle is delegation. When you organize, you make specific assignments. Divide up and project and specific tasks, assign specific people to do specific tasks. What if after Nehemiah pep rally, he got all the people together and goes, okay, are you excited about building the wall? What if he did like, in Braveheart, he painted half of his face blue and he gave a real speech about generations to come and he goes, now go build the wall! And they just started running and tripping over one another and they all tried to build to the same part of the wall and you had one piece of the wall 40 feet high and the rest of it was 2 foot high. You know, it just don't make any sense. He had to have that thing organized. He had to have specific tasks. He couldn't just use motivation. There had to be organization. There had to be specific tasks, assignments. And so the key word in the passage that lets us know that Nehemiah knew what he was doing is the word sections. You know, anything is a cinch, an inch by an inch. Whatever you want to do, break it down into very small segments and you can do it. He used the word sections 13 times. He walked around the entire wall and divides it up almost counterclockwise. The only mention of American politics in the Bible is in verse 26. It mentions the Watergate. Right there in verse 26. Obviously, Nehemiah thought this out. He probably divided the wall up. When I was telling you about last week, he went around at midnight. He began to analyze the entire wall, went all the way around the wall. And so at midnight, he started thinking, okay, I need to break this up in section. I'm going to have one group do this section, and another group do this section, another group do this section. So he knew there had to be done in sections. There had to be assignments. He had to delegate. The task to do in delegation. So not only does he delegate, but he delegates a specific task. Number one, break down major goals into smaller tasks. This is the capacity to cut problems down to size. How do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. You know. Nehemiah asked the huge problem of builders building the wall by breaking it down into bite sizes. We're going to do it little bit by little bit. The second thing, develop a clean job description. Everyone deserves to know what is expected of them. The third thing, match the right person with the right task. The wrong person in the wrong task causes chaos. It causes all kinds of motivational problems. In good delegation, you've got to understand what the task is all about, and you've got to understand what person is good at, and you've got to put that task and that person together. Here's the thing. Everybody's responsibility is nobody's responsibility. Here we go. Let's everybody do this. And they go, yeah, let's do it. When you get there and there's not everybody there. Everybody's task is nobody's task. So somebody has got to assume specific responsibility of that task. Number four, principles of motivation. In organizing any project, allow for ownership. And this is what Nehemiah did a really good job at. Help people feel it's their project. In verse 10, he says, a guy made repairs opposite his house. You may not call that just reading through the book of Nehemiah, but he made repairs opposite his house. Verse 23, another fellow repaired in front of his house. And in verse 28, another beside his house. The priest repaired each in front of his own house. And in verse 29, repaired in front of his house. In verse 30, a guy built his in front of his house, his living quarters. When you build a project, you let people do things that they're interested in. We should most likely want to be building on the wall in the area that interests us the most. So he felt like this, you know, if they're going to build this wall, where would they most want to build the wall? They'd want to build the wall right outside their house. It was going to be the protection of their home, their garden, their family. So he goes, let's build right outside your house. You think about the sense it made to do that. It gave them ownership. It caused them to have a high level of motivation because it was right outside their house. Can you imagine you're out here and you're building your wall and you got your wall looking real good and you walk up here to your neighbor and you go, hey, you see my wall? You need to start working on your wall. Now see, they can just walk right around my wall and get in here because you don't have your wall built. So there's kind of like a sense of pride and a sense of desire and a sense of motivation. And, you know, I'm building the wall to protect my house. It's like some people, they'll do stuff, but they're not motivated. Two guys were laying brick, and one guy said, what are you doing? He said, I'm making eight. In other words, I'm laying brick for 8 hours, I'm going home. They asked the other guy, what are you doing? He said, I'm building a cathedral. Which one do you think was more motivated? The one putting in eight or the one that was building a cathedral? And so he realized that he needed to motivate them. He had to give them ownership because ownership is what motivates people. And he knew that they would do it because it protected their own home. And they would do a better job because it was the one right in front of their own home. It would save time because there's no commuting. They can walk right out in the morning and start to work, go back home at lunch. Nehemiah is simply saying that the project make it as convenient as possible and as easy as possible, and people will come and they'll help. Verse 1, it said, Eliasib, the high priest, and his fellow workers went to work and rebuilt the sheep gate. That was the one closest to the temple. See, it was the high priest and it was the sheep gate. And why was the sheep gate there? That's where they brought the sheep in to slaughter them as the high priest for the people. So it makes sense. Not only did they do the wall in front of their house, they did the wall in front of their place of employment where they worked. Nehemiah allowed people to work in the area of their interest. That's a principle of organization. Leadership law is good organization allows workers to develop in their own areas. One thing we do here at Grace, we do a temperament analysis on people. We can find out what their temperament is. We do a thing called shape, your spiritual gifts, what you have a heart to do, your abilities, your personality, your experiences. And we can pretty much tell from your temperament and your shape what you are good at and what you would be good at in any job. And so you match these people up. Grace, here at Grace Church, is a great example. If you've got an idea, you've got a gift, you got an interest, then it's yours. And, you know, we allow people to do things in the church and have ownership of their ministry. I'm going to tell you how different that is than the way I used to do church. Used to, we like have a job come empty. We needed somebody to fill this job. And go, hey, you, will you do this job? And we would just pull somebody in. And, you know, they would do it until they died. And so normally, you know, pretty soon people realize they never volunteered for nothing because they didn't want to do it until they died. The other thing is when I went to churches, they had these boards. You know, and it's like you'd have this board, and this board had been established years ago, and this board made decisions about the church. Well, the thing is, when these boards were created, there probably was a project that was tied to what they were maybe had interest in or they were good at, but the boards just stayed on because once they just stayed there forever, it seemed like. And so what happened if you needed to get something in the children's department, that board had to meet, and the board had to decide whether they needed this in the children's department. Well, the only problem is the board never worked in the children's department. They don't have a clue what they need in children. They don't even know what they're doing in it. They don't even know that we had a children's department sometimes. You know, it's like they're upstairs somewhere. And so the thing is, we started letting the people that do the work make the decision. That's exactly what Nehemiah did. If they were workers at the sheep gate, he let them build the sheep gate. You know, it just made common sense. Like this guy, he went to this board meeting, and they knew he wasn't on the board, and they wanted to know what he was doing there. And they said, "Don't you realize this is a board meeting?" He said, "There's nobody more bored in this church than I am." Yeah, they didn't quite understand, but most boards don't either. I love this one example of this board. You know, it's typical. This is typical way that most boards I've ever been on works. They come and this guy, they were voting on whether they were going to buy a chandelier for the church. And this one deacon stood up. He said, I'm against it. And he said, "I got three reasons I'm against buying a chandelier." He said, "Number one, there's nobody in our church that can spell chandelier." You know, that's just right there. And number two, there's nobody in our church can even play a chandelier if we had it. And the third thing is what we really need around here is a light fixture, so I'm against it. That would be really funny, but I'm not kidding. That's the kind of words I had. And it really don't make sense. And so what we do, the donut committee, that welcoming committee, you really don't realize how important it is for people to come and fellowship and wait while one service lets out. But the donut ministry, they get to make all the decision on the donut ministry. If they want jelly-filled donuts, they're going to have jelly donuts. If they want to have crunchy donut, it doesn't matter. They get to make all the decision on the donut ministry and welcoming people. They probably know anyway from what people eat and they don't eat. Each department, the nursery, the children, the youth, they make the decision because they're doing the work. You know, it makes a whole lot more sense to let people doing the work make the decisions for that work. And so when people come to us, they go, "Oh, Pastor, I've got a great idea for a ministry." Good, I don't hear it. "Well, we could do this and this and this and this." Kimosabe, who is we? Who are you talking about? We. You said you had a great idea. And so when people have a great idea, we let them do that ministry. We're not going to do it for them. If you just got an idea, but you don't have nobody to do it, you just got a pipe dream. You ate too many beans the night before and you dreamed something, you know? And so what it is, we let people, if you got a great idea, bring it to the table. Let's get it started. There's a lot more ministries that could be going on here at Grace, but you get the idea, we let you do it. We let you do it. We let you get a team together. And you put a team and you invite other people to share in your vision. And you do just what this Nehemiah did. You start pulling people together. You get them involved. You get them excited. You share the vision. They get excited about the vision. Pretty soon, you've got a ministry team and you're doing it and excited. You're excited. You've got ownership. They got ownership. And it goes. I tell you what don't go is when you got an idea and you try to give that idea to somebody else and they never had the idea and they're not motivated by it and they're not turned on by it. They don't get it. And so the thing is, Nehemiah got that. And so he let them build around those areas that they had ownership. And so Grace, we do that. We let people have ownership of the jobs, the ministry they do. The fifth thing is the principle of cooperation. Encourage teamwork. Whenever you've got a project of any size, you need to organize it. And realize that we accomplish so much more together than we do as individuals. The passage is this kind of nightmare passage you don't want to have when you're playing Russian roulette with God's will. The point is, is that we all do better when we work together. The key phrase is next to him and next to them. It's actually used 20 times in this passage. Next to him or next to them, 20 times. Nehemiah was working clockwise around the entire wall. They helped each other. They encouraged each other. Next week we're going to talk about that they were even being attacked at the very same time. B.C. Forbes, the founder of Forbes magazine, said you spell success T-E-A-M-W-O-R-K, teamwork. You know, I've used the acrostic team, together everyone accomplishes more as a team. Coming together is a beginning. I want you to write this down. Coming together is the beginning. Keeping together is when progress is being made, when you stay together. Third, thinking together is unity. And fourth, working together is success. I'm going to tell you something. Out of those four things, the most important of those four things is unity. Together, we can do things we can't do as individuals. How many of you have ever seen a flock of geese flying through the air? And they've got this formation. And you know, what are they doing? They're trying to fake out to somebody. They're like an airplane, like they're a big jet flying through the air. I saw a thing on organization the other day. This big old fish was chasing after these little fish. And so these little fish got smart. These little fish, they formed in a school the shape of a big old fish. And they scared the other fish away. Now that's smart, folks. That is really smart. But these geese, they'll fly in this formation. And there's one geese up front, you know, he's squawking orders. And he's taking the headwind. And he'll fly and he's leading the, you know, he's leading the way, headed south for the winter or whatever. Well, they have this formation. And after so long, that front geese will fall out of formation. And somebody else will move up and he'll flow to the back. And he won't have as much headwind, and he can you know, flop, and he can get on down the road a little bit easier. They have found that when geese, they can fly 72% farther in formation than they can fly by themselves. 72% further when they're in that formation. That's amazing, isn't it? You say, well, how did those geese figure that out? Was there like one really smart geese, and he told the others, no, God put that creativity, and God put that organization in those geese. And it's amazing that they can fly south in the winter with 72% further, you know, accuracy. And it's just God loves formation. God loves organization. God loves that when we get together and we work together. When we cooperate together, when there is teamwork, there is great growth in anything you're a part of. Cooperation is a greater motivation than competition. You know, a lot of times people try to, well, we're going to put this team against that team and it's competition. Competition does not breed unity. It usually breeds disunity. It lasts because you feel like you're together on a winning team. People influence each other. They influence the people they are next to for good or bad. And so you want those that are positive. You want those that are willing to work. You want those that are willing to be on a team. Ecclesiastes 4, 9, and 10. I want you to get this verse right here. It's a very, very powerful verse. Two can accomplish more than twice as much as one. Now, I want you to catch that, because if you didn't catch it, there's a little something in there that you didn't catch. Two can accomplish more than twice as much as one. We go, well, I got that. You know, two can do more than one. But folks, that is not what it says. It says two can accomplish more than twice as much as one. For the result can be much better. You can do more than, not just two can do twice as much, but two can do twice as much as one. I found little projects around here at the church. You can hire one guy, and that one guy won't get very much work done because they're having to do this and they can't do it by themselves. They need another partner. But I've found if you get the right two people working together, those two people can do more than, you know, if you had one working on that side and one working on that side and they were working separately, and you put those two together and say, I want you to do that side and then do that side, you would get more than twice as much when they work together. It just makes sense. You can do more. You can accomplish more. And God knows that. Nehemiah knew that. When you're building an organization, a business, a church, or social club, a lay ministry, you follow these principles. Keep it simple. Work with those who want to work. Make specific assignments. Allow for ownership and encourage teamwork. Encourage the teamwork. That's a mark of good organization. Leadership law is good organizations provide supportive climate of trust and teamwork. Teamwork. That's the mark of a good organization. They provide a supportive climate of trust and teamwork. In the Bible, when referring to Christians in the early church, the phrase one another is used 58 times. One another, one another. Love one another, care for one another, pray for one another. Was God trying to say something? You bet. He was trying for us to get the message that together we can accomplish a whole lot more than by ourselves. There is no such thing as long ranger Christianity. We are here together. God wants us to be together. God wants us to be a team. God wants us to cooperate. God can overlook almost anything in a church. You know, I think about when we first started, we had a crummy building, poor facilities. I think about the early church when they started, they didn't have no facilities. And when they did finally, you know, move into caves and this and that and the other, it was poor facilities. And in the beginning, they had poor doctrine. They didn't have it all figured out yet. And guess what? Most all organizations today don't have all their doctrine figured out, including us. We just all think we do. You know, I love to go in the Smithsonian in Washington and walk around and see stuff and think, that was the brightest idea in your age? They got a chair there, and it showed this big old drill thing. And I was wondering what, so I'm standing there in the Smithsonian reading that. And you know what it was? It was a chair that they used to relieve depression. You know, if somebody was depressed in their head, the best thing to do is drill a big hole in their head. And I'm thinking, and that was the smart ones in their day. They was the smartest, and they were smart now. They were the wise ones. And I think about one day we're going to look back and we're going to look at some of the things we've done. And we'll be done it enthusiastically, but somebody will go, what in the world were they thinking? What were they thinking when they did that? And so all we can do is do the best we can. We can do it as honestly as we can. We can do it as dedicated as we can. We can do it, you know, fully for God. And so I think about the early church, though. The one thing God will not overlook, He'll overlook, you know, no facilities. He'll overlook poor facilities. He'll overlook a lot of things, but God will not overlook disunity. I want you to write that down. God will not overlook disunity. In the first 10 chapter of Acts, 10 times He said they were in one accord. They were of one heart. They were unified. When you have unification, like they did in Acts, you will have the power of the Church of Acts. There is power in teamwork. There is power in unity. Working together in this atmosphere of trust and teamwork. Let me tell you something. I was talking to Tim's wife, Linda. She's here today. Glad to have you, Linda. And she was going, I just hope it snows again. I'm going, no. They've already let school out so many times. And, you know, they're trying to do that. But she said, I love the beautiful snow. But I want to give you something. Snow is beautiful. And snow is a beautiful demonstration of what God can do with a bunch of flakes. Now, some of you are already moving in a direction that I'm heading. Individually, I can't do much, and you can't do much. Snowflakes are the same way. Snowflakes are pretty frail by themselves. But if enough of those snowflakes stick together, they can stop traffic. If enough snowflakes stick together, they can even stop school. If enough of those snowflakes stick together, they can cover this entire mountain. And that's what I'm telling you, folks. If God can take all of us flaky people, and He can get us to stick together and get unified in reaching this mountain for Jesus Christ, we will do it. Some people said, you can't start a Saturday night service. It's already been tried on this mountain, and it can't be done. Well, it's a good thing I'm going through Nehemiah, because I probably would have believed it. Because, see, Nehemiah, in 90 years, there's two other campaigns to rebuild the wall that did not succeed in the past 90 years. So when Nehemiah showed up on the scene, Of course, that's what they told him. Oh, we already tried that. It won't work. And we had a lot. You know, you come by yourself. We had a big old group of people last time, and we couldn't even do it then. You might as well go home. But Nehemiah was there, sent by God, and he believed if, with God's help, and if he unified the people and he had teamwork, they could do anything they set their minds to do. The early church, they unified. They were in one mind and one accord, and they took the gospel to the known world. Here's the thing. The sixth thing is administration. The principles implied all the way through the passage. You must supervise the work when you have any kind of project. And it's interesting in Nehemiah 3 that his name is not even mentioned, not once in that chapter. Where was he? He was out with his administrators. He was out supervising. He was doing what Tom Peter calls in the book called Passion of Excellence. It's called the MBWA, Management by Walking Around. He was doing management by walking around. He would walk around and he would see what was being done on the wall. He would offer suggestions. He would talk to supervisors and administrators. He would help them. I wrote down three examples of supervisors. He uses in the phrase, under their supervision, in verse 17. He said certain repairs were made under Rehum, in verse 18. Certain repairs were made under Babia. They were appointed supervisors who were helping control the work, manage it, administrate it, and make sure it was going on. There are two leadership laws you need to understand right here in this passage. Good organizations establish clear lines of authority. They not only have clear job descriptions, but they have clear lines of authority. You know who you're working with. People do what you inspect, not what you expect. You know, when we was building this church, you know, I'd go around and if I knew what I was doing, I would inspect what people were doing. And then other people that knew certain areas, they would inspect what certain people were doing. But, you know, we told our local county that we were going to build this building and we was going to do it right for God. But, you know, they didn't even believe us. Because they sent an inspector out and they would inspect. I remember I got plugs for all this wall up here and Bill Engelman started to put them in, and he put them all in. It took him like days. The inspector comes and goes, you should have bought the deep plugs. And so they're all going to come out. And it didn't bother me, but it really bothered Bill. I was their fierce leader on that one. And I had to take the bullet on that one. But I'm telling you, you know, any job, and I was thankful that they come around and inspect what we do. People don't do what you expect, they do what you inspect. You know, and if you're not willing to be open to being inspected, then you may be covering up something anyway. The thing is, they inspected the work. He was checking it out. He wanted to make sure it was all flowing together. The second principle, the seventh principle, is the principle of appreciation. This was very, very important. A good organization gives recognition to whom recognition is due. Zig Ziglar says you can accomplish anything you want to accomplish in life if you're willing to give enough, you know, willing to give them the credit. You know, if you're willing to give them the credit, you can accomplish anything you want to do. And here's the thing, Nehemiah knew that. He knew that principle. And you find in this chapter that, like you find in Hebrews 11, that hall of fame of faith. Nehemiah is doing the same thing here. He's honoring, it's like an honor roll of those that participated on the wall. Nehemiah's giving credit. And now 2,000, almost 3,000 years later, on the opposite side of the world, there's a pastor standing up here this morning mispronouncing their names all because Nehemiah mentioned who they were and what they did on that wall. That's amazing, folks. Notice several things about this principle of appreciation. Obviously, Nehemiah knew their names. He called them by name. In this passage, he tells of 38 individuals, names of guys and gals who've done an extra special good job. My question I want to ask you, are you in the kind of organization where you know the names of the people you work with? What about going around and as you're looking and you're inspecting, why not catch people when they're doing something right rather than just trying to catch them when they're doing something wrong? That goes for family, children. We got a thing around here we tell people in counseling, what is not appreciated is usually soon eliminated. we have women come in and go, well, I tell you what, I work, and you know, I work 40 hours, my husband worked 40 hours, but I have to do all the housework, and you know, I got all the laundry to do, and I can't even get them to bring the laundry to the laundry room. I have to go dig through their rooms and get their laundry and figure out what's dirty and what's not. And they complain and complain and complain. And so what we tell them, well, we teach them this, what is not appreciated is soon eliminated. So we say, go back home, and then just tell your teenagers, tell your kids, if they don't take it to the laundry room and it's not there on laundry day, it will not get done. Well, what about my kids wearing dirty stuff to school? Well, I'm sure they won't like that. And if they don't like it, maybe they'll start bringing it to the laundry room on laundry day. And you know, we've had a lot of them find that it really does work. Because, see, anything that you do that's not appreciated, if you quit doing it, they go, why aren't you not doing that? Well, they wasn't appreciated when you was done. And Nehemiah knew this. People want to be appreciated. We find this out in verse 20. He has the name of a man in this list of entire names. He gets an honorable mention. He says that this guy named Baruch, son of Zebiah, zealously, not just did it, he zealously repaired another section from the angle to the entrance of the house of Eliashib, the high priest. You need to circle zealously. That's the only person he gives that title. This guy, I don't know why he was zealous, but he was zealous. He was excited about doing it. Maybe he worked longer hours, maybe he worked faster, but Nehemiah gave him honor dimension. He was enthusiastic. You know what enthusiastic means? It starts off with the root word of in theos, in God. It means God possessed. Somebody that is enthusiastic is in God. He's possessed with God. He's excited. That's what I say. You've got to move people from external motivation, and I'll give you a few dollars, to internal motivation. What is in it for you? It's you're building the wall near your house. But folks, the people that really get it is the people that caught Nehemiah's vision, and they had an eternal motivation. They had an eternal motivation. They knew they were doing a work for God. They knew they were the people of God, the children of God. They were doing something that was important. They had eternal motivation. And they were enthusiastic about God's work. And they were God-possessed. Another interesting thing in verse 12. Shalom, son of Holiash, ruler of the half-district of Jerusalem, repaired the next section with the help of his daughters. Did you realize back then it's similar, not much different than it is over there now in those countries. The women walked like 10 steps behind the man. The women did not work with the men. The women were second class, third class citizens. But this guy, he got his daughters to help work on the wall. Smart guy. You know why? If you got some women working on the wall, there's some men going to come help those women. That's smart thinking out there. But it was not very common in that day. It was not. And then for Nehemiah to actually give credit to these women, it proved he was not some male chauvinist. It proved that he, you know, maybe that's not the way they normally do things. Maybe women do not do anything that men do. But Nehemiah said, they did it. I'm going to give them credit. I want to say these women worked on the wall just as hard as you men. I'm going to tell you, we build this building right here. We had a bunch of retired people that come and work here today. And it was women and men. And I tell you what, the women give the men a run for their money. I tell you what, we went over and tore down one building, build this building, and then women could sling a sledgehammer. They could tear up some stuff. You get women in the right frame of mind, they can tear up stuff. They can tear it up. But anyway, we tore it up, and we put it, redone it, and painted it, and remodeled it, and brought it over here and built this building. And I'll tell you, women did it. And we had a daytime crew, and we had a nighttime crew, and people worked together, and we got excited about the work. In verse 5, the next section was repaired by the men of Tekoa. And it tells here, this is some little hick town, kind of a wide spot in the road, and there was nothing there. But it said in that little quaint town, the nobles, their upper crust, you know what the upper crust was, the nobles, they were a bunch of crumbs held together by their dough. And these upper crust nobles, they were too good to put their shoulder to the work with the supervisors. It's interesting, not only do we know 3,000 years later the people that worked, but we also know 3,000 years later the people that didn't work. Leadership law, good organization recognizes, rewards efforts of those that do the work. A lot of the churches run on an 80-20 principle. 80% of the work in most churches is done by 20% of the people. I'm glad to say that we're a little bit better than that here at this church. We got more people participating, and hopefully we're going to even have more. I want to tell you about that. If you're interested in being a part of the Saturday night service, take this out and fill it out today in your bulletin. We've already got about somewhere around 50 or 60 people that are interested in the Saturday night service. So as we start up, it won't be such a small crowd. But we've already got about 20, 23, 24 people that are willing to work in that Saturday night service. So what are we doing? We're reproducing, giving people more options. We've got more people working. We're building a stronger church. It may strain us, but anytime you want to make your muscles bigger, you've got to strain them a little bit. Because we're going to become a stronger church because of it. I appreciate, you know, and some of you, you've championed the cause of the first service, and you're going to keep, that's your service. You helped build it. It's what some of you championed the cause of moving here and starting our second service. And so that's your service. You've given your sweat and blood to. You're going to stay in that service. That's fine. Some of you, though, you're going to be a part of that Saturday night service. You're going to always look back and know you were a part of that. And all the other services. So I am thankful that God is moving on hearts and it works out better for your schedules and hopefully all the friends and neighbors you're going to bring to that service. The thing is, this principle, Nehemiah did not get uptight with the people that did not particularly do that. He just honored the ones and rewarded the ones that did. Romans 14 and 12 said, so that each one of us will give an account to himself before God. That's ultimately the thing. We all have to give an account of ourselves before God one day. God knows what we do and why we do it, the reasons and our motivation. God knows. 1 Corinthians 15 and 58, always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Folks, God always sees what you do. God always honors what you do. He honors what you give. Matter of fact, most churches, about 80% of the money is given by about 20% of the people. That's just the way it is in most churches. I'd say even at that, we're above the rule on that. We've got a lot of good givers and lovers, and it's a great church to be a part of. Here's the thing. In Romans 12, 4 and 8, just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so it is in the body of Christ. We who are many form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We all have different gifts. Use them. In other words, we all have different gifts. Some is going to be gifted in that. Some is going to, but it's just everybody doing something. Everybody being a part of something. And so here's the thing. God instructed Nehemiah. God organized Nehemiah. I think the closer we get to God, the more enthusiastic we become about everything. I think the more closer we get to God, and just like He formed those geese to form God could have said, oh, they're a bunch of geese, forget them. You know, they can get there as soon as they can. They can walk for all I care. They'll figure it out. But God not only wanted them to have the comfort of being going south in the winter, some of that geese stuff's caught on to some of the people around here. You go south every winter. But they form that formation and they go south. Why? God wanted them to be in the warmth. God wanted it to be easier. God wants your daily job at work to be easy. God wants it to be organized. He knows you'll be happier if you're more organized. God knows you'll be happy if you're enthused and excited about what you do in life. Get enthused. Get in theos. Get in God. And realize, you know, you may be teaching a class, but no, you're teaching the future of our town. They're going to be future citizens in our town. You're teaching them. If you're laying brick, you're not just laying brick and putting in eight. You're building something. And you can look back. I love building because I love when I go by and there's nothing there on that lot. And then you go by and there's a little starts to be, and you go there and you think, look at that nice looking building. And not too long ago, there was nothing there. It's amazing to me. I love to see things being built and see how it's built and see how it comes together. And just realize that didn't just happen. Somebody organized it. Somebody put it on paper. And somebody done exactly what was on the paper and it came out beautiful. God is going to do some beautiful things in your life. God is going to help some of you make your daily life a lot easier. God, He's not for you just working harder. He wants you to work smarter. He wants life to be grand for you. He wants it to be excited for you. And God can help you do that. I pray as we go through these principles of Nehemiah, you realize that God, if He's in a bunch of birds flying south for the winter, and He's concerned about how effortless that could be, that it could be 70, they could be 72%, 74% more effective. Don't you think God cares and wants you to be 74% more effective in whatever you do? That your job becomes easier. That you're the one that when they're looking for someone to give a raise to, they don't have far to look because they know who is doing their job enthusiastically. When they're looking for a person to promote to the next level, they don't look far because they've got a child of God over here that's enthusiastic. They're in God. They're excited. They're not just putting in 40, but they're doing it enthusiastic, and it don't take them long. You know, you can almost throw God's people in any arena of life, and the cream always rises to the top. You know, Joseph's brothers could throw him in a cave, and he could be sold to a bunch of caravan of gypsies. And he can get to another town and be falsely accused in Egypt. And he can be thrown in prison. But before you know it, he's running the prison. And before you know it, he's, every time you put that guy, you can take Daniel and his men and you can throw him on a very unkind king. And before you know it, Daniel is running. You can take Nehemiah, and Nehemiah he's not even in his own country. He's a foreigner. But before you know it, he's the right-hand man to the king. I'm telling you, a child of God that gets enthusiastic, gets in God, gets God-possessed about doing what is right and doing every day to the greatest amount of your ability will always rise to the top every single time. And that's what I want for you. I want you to be the movers and shakers. I want you to be the one getting the raises. I want you to be the one being kept on your job when other people are being laid off. Because, folks, you deserve it when you get turned on to God and you do what is right. Let us bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank You today. God, I pray that You would use our people, Lord, that they would learn these principles and they would rise up and be the head and not the tail of the areas that they work in. That they would be the most creative. They would be the most cooperative. They would have the greatest amount of unity and teamwork. And God, I just pray that as they do, Lord, they'll see their life get easier. They see their jobs get easier, their families get easier. All the things that they organize, whether it be school functions or after school functions or sports events, it would all flow better because they understand these principles of leadership. And God, I pray today, if there be one here today that don't know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, that this will be their day. That this will be their day that they turn to Jesus Christ and say, Jesus, I want to be enthused about life. I want to be excited. I want to wake up and be excited about each day that I live here on earth. And also being excited about going to heaven. I ask it today in Jesus' name.